I would like to welcome our viewers to a conversation about family medicine and value-based care. I am Amy Mullins, a family physician and the medical director of quality improvement at the American Academy of Family Physicians. I would like to ask my guests this evening to introduce themselves and give us a little bit of information about where they practice and who they are. Leisa, why don't you go first?
Sure. I'm Leisa Bailey. I'm a family physician in private practice in a small town in the panhandle of Florida, Bonifay, Florida. I've been in practice there for 29 years, and I do a little bit of everything from obstetrics to emergency medicine in my local hospital, as well as inpatient medicine and nursing home medicine.
Great. Thank you. Lee?
Hi, I'm Lee Mills. I'm a family physician and currently practice in Tulsa, Oklahoma as medical director of St. John Clinic. I come from a full scope of practice background with hospital medicine and obstetrics, and now find myself focusing on the administrative aspects of moving the whole healthcare system towards value-based care.
Great, thank you. We all know that value-based payment is a way to move away from fee-for-service towards paying for value, and that's what we really want to dive into during our conversation over the next few minutes. So our discussion is going to focus on four main topics. First, we're going to get your thoughts on value-based payment. Then we're going to talk about how you are incorporating that into your current practice situation. And then as you've been doing that, what are the pros and cons, the challenges you face, the successes you've seen? And then we're going to talk a little bit about where you see value-based payment going for you or for the country in general. It's kind of your thoughts on the crystal ball that you have in your office, what you see for the future. So let's get started first with just how value-based payment is changing the face of family medicine, how it's changing how we see quality, how we see patient outcomes, how we deal with continuity, those kinds of issues. Who wants to dive in first? Lee, I'm picking on you first.
Sure. Value-based payment is I think, both exciting and exhilarating and yet scary, because it's like we've been talking about, it's going to happen. We're edging up to the cliff, and now we're about to jump over because it is here. Things are tipping over for many practices and health systems. I think it holds the future of primary care and family medicine. Are we going to be able to finally pull ourselves away from the kind of the reductionist ideas of medicine where, you know, all care equals a visit and everything about documentation is for billing, to actually go back to the relational creatures of caring for communities and populations, which is the heart of what takes all of us to family medicine. So I think our time, you know, as we've been saying since you know, for three decades is mm-hmm. here, I think it is almost upon us. So I'm really excited about where we are in the specialty.
Great. Leisa?
And from my perspective, value-based medicine has really always been there. And I have never had the type of practice where I focused on how many patients I can see. I have always wanted to take as good a care of those patients as possible. And value-based medicine actually is starting to give me an opportunity to actually reap financial rewards from taking care of my patients in a way that values them. And I love the fact that by doing things like chronic care management and wellness visits, and psychosocial and integrative behavioral health, I can actually be reimbursed for those things. My patients get better value as well, better care, and I can actually hire new staff as well. And so the value is coming into the lifestyle of my practice as much as the financial side of it.
So I'm gonna dig into that a little bit and kind of take us to our next question, because it sounds like you have really incorporated some value-based payment concepts into your practice. So talk a little bit about some of the new codes you might be using or some of the services that you offer in your practice that others may not be doing.
Well, we started with the annual wellness visits. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure most folks are aware that there are three different wellness visits that are reimbursed by Medicare now. And there's what's called an IPPE for an initial wellness visit right after someone becomes eligible for Medicare. And then there's a first annual wellness visit that has, you know, the first time you do that wellness visit, and then they also reimburse for annual wellness visits after that subsequent annual wellness visits. And at first, it even took me a little while to see that these were going to be valuable because a lot of them were things that I was already doing as part of my regular visits. Mm-hmm. But now it makes me take the time to go over all of those health maintenance issues. And I know my patients are having those health maintenance issues done. And when I'm seeing them for their regular visits for diabetes and hypertension, I don't have to worry, did I remember to ask them about their colonoscopy? Did I remember to make sure they had their pap smear? Because if I'm doing those annual wellness visits, those are going to be captured. And so we started there. And then that was sort of a jumping off point for everything else that we're doing. In the beginning, I was doing all of those myself. Mm-hmm. Now I'm utilizing my office staff to do most of those. And I just basically review what they did and sometimes, you know, pop my head in to talk about things like end of life counseling. And so those annual wellness visits, I have picked up so many things on those annual wellness visits mm-hmm. that I never dreamed I would. Patients who were depressed that never really gave me any sign of the fact that they were depressed. And again, picking up colon cancers with colon cancer screening, I thought I did a great job of all of my health maintenance before. It was not until I started doing those wellness visits that I realized that I wasn't doing nearly as good a job as I thought I was.
That always seemed to be the case. I found that exact same thing. Yeah. Lee, how have you been integrating value-based payment concepts into the work that you're doing?
Well, very similar to Leisa, I think the annual wellness visit is really foundational, one of kind of what I think are two foundational pillars to start transforming your practice from usual customary workflow focused on everything as a visit and billing your fee for service to thinking more about a population and a global relationship. So annual wellness visits, exactly as Leisa described, I agree 100%. And also we focused on transition care management visits, which is nice to help get, you know, overt payment for all the additional coordination and care that your staff are doing for that first 30 days after hospital visit. It's also some nice external self-discipline to get the patients into the office inside 2 weeks, just knowing that, you know, by the first week, if you don't get them into the office, you've already missed about 40% of your hospital readmissions. And so it's just been really good for us to take both better care, prevent hospital readmissions for simple stuff like I didn't get the prescription or I got the prescription, but I don't want to take it from that guy in the hospital until I talk to you, right? Those are so easy if we just know about them. And so those are really two key services.
Yeah. Or, you know, I found I have this prescription, but I also have one at home. So I'm taking both of them.
Of course.
And it's usually a duplicate. And that was a problem.
Right.
Are either of you doing chronic care management?
We are. And in fact, we started doing chronic care management right when it rolled out. And being in a small practice, basically the management of my practice is very important to me. And I really do as much office management as anyone else in the practice. And when I started reading about chronic care management in our Academy's magazine, Family Practice Management, I thought, you know, this would not be that difficult to do. And I think we have everything we need to do it. And so basically I tasked one of my nurses to be the chronic care nurse. And that was only just a part-time job to start with. And so that January, every Medicare patient that came in, I assessed to see if they would be appropriate. And if they were appropriate at first, I enrolled them and I came up with their care plan completely myself and then turned them over to the care manager nurse. And we just slowly added those patients because we were doing most of this stuff anyway. And we just started recording our time. And between myself and my nurse, we almost always had 20 minutes on those patients. Mm-hmm. And then we started submitting the codes and they paid so well. And, you know, we never got a rejection on our chronic care management. And within a year, we had around 100 patients. And very quickly, I had to hire more staff and have a nurse do nothing but that. And right now we have about 200 patients in our chronic care management program. And we have a nurse that does nothing but chronic care management all day long. And she will come in and she, after I tell the patients about the program, she'll come in, she'll talk to them. She and I developed the care plan together. She mainly does most of the work based on some guidelines and templates that I've developed for her. And that has been probably the biggest benefit to our practice. From the perspective of my inpatient service, and I do take care of my own inpatients here, my inpatient medicine decreased dramatically when we had chronic care management because we kept those patients out of the hospital. And I love that because I really don't like getting up early in the morning and rounding on five or six patients. I'd rather have one or two every 1 or 2 weeks, you know, and that's how it is now.
Well, and that's huge for, you know, the new value-based payment contracts that are really looking at hospital admissions and, you know, not really, you know, making that a very undesirable effect for your patients. And then also, I am assuming, based on what you've been telling me, that this program paid for itself. When you say you had to hire new staff, that wasn't a detriment to your practice.
No, it was not. In fact, we are now, I'm now of the mindset that I do not hire a new staff member anymore unless I know they can pay for themselves. And through all of these value-based procedures, they do pay for themselves. We have the chronic care nurse who is now totally paying for herself. She also can do wellness visits. And so she does, she generally does about 4 or 5 wellness visits a week, and along with her chronic care. We've also hired at this point a part-time health educator who also is one of the personnel that can do wellness visits independently. And she also does my comprehensive cognitive evaluations with me just popping in at the end and doing the last portion of it, the physical exam, the plan, but she does, it administers all the tools. And she also does a lot of diabetic education and other education where if I have a patient that I know needs a little something extra, we do shared visits where she will come in and she'll talk to the patient for 30 minutes about a meal plan for diabetes or foot care. And then she'll have my note ready and I come in and just quickly, if I need to make a medication adjustment, and she assists me on those level 4 diabetes visits also.
Nice.
And she pays for herself. She pays for, she's part-time, one wellness visit pays for her day's work, and actually, and then some. And she oftentimes sees 4 wellness visits in a day.
So that is a lot of pros to the things that you have added to your clinic. Lee, I'm going to make you talk about maybe some of the cons that you have seen while you have, you know, tried to do some of this work. Because we know this work is hard, and it's, you know, and I'm going to get back to Leisa because I'm going to let her think about some of the things that, you know, as she's done some of these things, I'm sure it has not always been an easy road because none of these roads are ever easy. And, you know, you'd like to think they're a super highway going somewhere when really they're like a slow twisting brick road up a mountain. So tell me about some of the things that you have encountered that have been some of the challenges as you've implemented some of these programs.
Sure. And I like your description. Going from wherever we are to the glorious future, you always imagine there's a straight line from point A to point B, but actually looks a lot like a plate of spaghetti in the middle.
Yes.
Getting there is often a curved road. Much like Lisa's practice, we have, we're in CPC Plus, so we're not able to do the chronic care management codes, but that's because we're assumed to be doing those services and getting a care management fee. So we also have invested in nurse care managers, which, you know, like most practices, true BSN nurses were priced out of ambulatory primary care 15 years ago, and all we had was medical assistants. We have now incorporated nurse care managers into our practices. We have invested in behaviorists. So among our distributed primary care network, we have a combination of LPCs or LCSWs, covering all of our clinics, providing behavioral health services one-on-one with our staff. So you know that there's somebody down the hall these days and these times if you need to make a hot handoff for an important referral or place an urgent referral, and they'll call the patient within the hour, which has been very, very helpful. We've been able to add a part-time PharmD, which has been helpful, a helpful asset to think about throwing at the most difficult or complex diabetic heart failure type patients. That's gotten us some real benefit. And then also a social worker asset just to help the care managers and the office staff take those, you know, very tip of the spear social problems, help work through community resources, and then also helping us pilot our social determinant of need projects that are moving forward at the health system level. So those are all exciting things that the transition to value is helping bring us. There's been a few working in a not-for-profit health system brings some challenges, one of which is health systems are very risk-averse. Mm-hmm. And a physician or practice like Leisa, who is nimble, understands the management and their expenses, and can make an analysis and shift rapidly, is able to, just as she's describing, absolutely take advantage of these opportunities and see incomes go up, you know, fairly quickly and fairly noticeably. Mm-hmm. Not-for-profit health systems are governed by fair market value law, which essentially says I can't pay any of my physicians more than their fair market value, which is defined by published surveys, mainly based on fee-for-service RVUs. So one of the challenges in my situation is, though our revenue is tipping over, we're getting as much revenue for non-fee-for-service visits and value-based care as we do seeing patients, I can't necessarily pay my docs any better. I can pay them different. I just can't pay them better yet. And so that's a real break on the adoption, the enthusiasm among your practicing docs. I think we're working through that, though. It's just going to take time and transition, and a lot of the Academy's advocacy is helping in that regards. There's some interesting conundrums about the stark self-referral laws, in that when you're in an integrated system, we would like to be able to hook population quality to our compensations, mm-hmm. but that can run afoul of some of the self-interest laws, like Stark, that Medicare hasn't updated in about 20 years. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting, some aspects of, you know, CMS are pushing us to incorporate value-based care, integrate care, talk with colleagues and partners about services, and other parts are actually seeming to actively disincentivize and resist those things. And I know it just takes time to work through all that.
Interesting. That is an interesting conundrum you find yourself in.
Yeah.
Leisa, as you were integrating and doing these things in your practice, what would you say was the biggest hurdle that you had to overcome?
I was thinking about that, because probably the biggest hurdle was the amount of change that I asked my staff mm-hmm. to do over a fairly short period of time. And when I say a fairly short period of time, we've done a lot of change over about the last 4 to 5 years, because our practice today looks totally different than it did 10 years ago. And sometimes I think my staff felt like every time we had a staff meeting, they were sitting on their edge of their seats thinking, oh, what new thing is she going to ask us to do this time? And there was a lot of that. Fortunately, I have staff members, most of whom are younger than I, and most of whom were able to make those changes. I had a couple of staff members who are very valuable staff members, but just were very resistant to change. Mm-hmm. And I was able to utilize the ones that wanted to make changes to do what they could do, but also some of the older staff members that were very good at what they did, I realized I needed to leave them doing what they do and utilize some of these other staff members to do some of the changes. And overall, I think they're all very happy. I have staff members that have been with me for 15 years and more. Another change was how fast our chronic care program blossomed. And very quickly, we had more chronic care patients than we really could take care of in terms of taking those 20 minutes every month. Mm-hmm. And so we weren't really sure at first if we were going to be able to support a full-time chronic care nurse. And about that time, we had people knocking on our doors from agencies mm-hmm. wanting to do our chronic care and wanting to do it and then split revenue with us. And they really promised the world in terms of, we will take such good care of your patients. We'll be on call for them at night. We will communicate with you really well. And at that time, we actually decided to try that out. And we signed a contract with a chronic care company that had its own nurses, that was a big company. And we told them that we just were going to do it for 6 months. And we actually made them agree to let us keep half of our chronic care patients and let them keep the other half. And so we kept 100 and we gave them 100. And we said at the end of 6 months, we're going to decide if this is what we want to do. And we did it for 6 months and realized about 4 months into it that it was just not the same. Mm-hmm. That even though they were doing everything they promised to do, it was not the same as having someone in our office who knew those patients intimately, who those patients would drop by the office just to see. Mm-hmm. And so after 6 months, we said, you know what, we need to do this ourselves. And that's when we hired a full-time person. And we've done it in-house since then. And not only is it financially much more rewarding, but the patients love our chronic care nurse. Her name is Hillary. And they have a relationship with Hillary. And when they come by to see me for an appointment, mm-hmm. they always stop by Hillary's office on the way out. And a lot of times they just come in to see her. She does a lot of her chronic care face-to-face. She does a lot of it over the phone too. But she knows more. And she's an LPN. She's not a registered nurse. Mm-hmm. This is a small town. But she's a social worker more than she is anything. And she's a counselor also. Mm-hmm. It's worked out real well.
That's great. So, Lee, I'm going to flip this back to you and ask you, get out your crystal ball and look into the future for as far as you want to look next week, next month, next year, 10 years from now, and tell me, where do you see this going for you or for the country or for both?
Wow. Any of us that have crystal balls probably would be in a different industry. But it does feel like the transition we've been seeing from, you know, usual and customary charges to RVRBS to single double conversion factor and single conversion factor and now up to CPC and ACOs and now the primary care first model seems like in the between 5 and 10 year time frame that primary care has moved to a per member per month capitation with, I think, probably a flat risk-adjusted flat visit fee and a defined basket of services with some risk-adjusted quality or savings bonuses in there. So CPC Plus was using a quality bonus system, whereas the ACOs are using a shared savings incentive system. Mm-hmm. That primary care first is shifting towards the back to the shared savings. Feels like given CPC was 7 small geographic regions, CPC Plus is 14 states, essentially, and now Primary Care First is 26 states. I believe that's where Medicare is going in the 5+ year version. That's what primary care is going to look like. So all of the team-based care, all the quality improvement, all of the chronic care management and population health we've been talking about, and Dr. Bailey's practices is doing so well on, that is the future of primary care. And I think it's probably going to be in the less than 10-year marketing.
And so, you know, primary care first, for those that may be listening and aren't aware, is the new payment model that CMS has released. And I like to say that the devil's going to be in the details. We know probably somewhere between 50 and 75%, I would say, of what they have in store for this payment model. All of the details have not been released. And I think that I'm really curious to know a little bit more before I make my final judgment on that payment model. But I think the easiest way to define it is to say it's kind of the next step in CPC Plus. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, CPC Plus 3. It's, you know, moving on from there. If you've been doing CPC Plus, it's a movement on from there, except if you've been in CPC Plus, you can't participate in the first year of primary care first. But that's kind of an easy way to describe what it is it's the next version of CPC Plus, with many details yet to come, I think, from CMS to see exactly how that's going to unfold. Leisa, what do you think the future is looking like for you or for the country?
Well, first, I just want to say, Lee, I'm jealous of you being in a CPC Plus model. When I started reading about that and I knew what my practice was doing, I thought, oh, that would be the best model to be in. And we wanted so much to be in something like that, but it did not come to Florida. Mm-hmm. And so we were not able to do that. And to be perfectly honest, even with all of the things that we're doing, it has become more and more difficult to keep afloat in private practice, mm-hmm. even with all of the value-based care. And now I'm in a position where I can hire staff when I need it because they pay for themselves. But so much of the other overhead involved in a practice has gotten to be greater and greater. And so since I'm now, you know, not a spring chicken in my practice, although I would love to be still doing this when I'm 80, and I hope to be right where I am when I'm 80, I've actually started looking at the, I actually got approached by some of the local hospitals in my area about joining their networks. And one of my reservations was, would I still be able to practice medicine the way I'm practicing it? And are they going to be interested in things like chronic care and wellness visits and collaborative care, which we really haven't talked about a lot, but we're doing the Medicare, the CMS collaborative care, behavioral integration for family medicine also. And to my surprise, that was one of the very reasons they were interested in our practice, because their clinics were not doing this, and they actually saw this as a way to actually improve their own clinics. For the last few years, I've been part of an ACO, and when we joined the ACO, their big emphasis in education was on value-based care, and yet we were already doing that. And then when they basically tabulate all of their measures at the end of the year, a couple of weeks ago, I got my report card. And basically, without really trying, without doing anything but these value-based measures that we're doing, my numbers for my clinic exceeded my local ACO, exceeded our state ACO, exceeded our national ACO, not just by a little bit, but by a lot. We knocked the top out of it just by doing these measures, these chronic care management, the wellness visits. Mm-hmm. And so they're looking at that and saying, this is something we want our clinics to be doing too. Mm-hmm. And so they're making me offers now that are going to be really hard to refuse, especially since I'm used to practicing, you know, 80 hours a week, sometime with my, between my obstetrics and my hospital work. And I also work in the emergency room. And now as I'm getting a little older, I'm going to be able to do what I call semi-retire, which means go back to a 40-hour work week in my practice, which is what I'd like to do for about the next 20 years. So that's kind of where we're headed right now, is looking at possibly selling our practice and teaching some of these other clinics how to do what we're doing.
Yeah, and sharing your expertise with more people, which would be fantastic. And taking that.
And still practicing though, still doing what I love to do in my community. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, I would like to thank you both for your time and your expertise tonight and sharing your thoughts on value-based payment with me and with our viewers. And I would like to thank our viewers for watching and taking the time out of your day to listen to our conversation on value-based payment. And I would like to remind everyone that you can find out more information and stay up to date on the American Academy of Family Physicians' efforts around value-based payment at aafp.org. So thank you for watching.